Talk Radio, you're in to all things music.
Welcome to Vinyl Night, powered by InterTalk Radio, the groove of the music industry. I'm your host, John Robinson, coming to you live from Vinyl Night Studios in beautiful Thousand Oaks, California. This show features some of the best and most influential people in the music industry. Each week, we will feature an intimate, candid, and in-depth one-on-one with all the musicians, recording engineers, singers, and producers that have changed the world. Before we get started, got a big shout-out to my sponsors, DW Drums, Paiste Cymbals, Remo Drumheads, Regal Tip Drumsticks and Brushes, Blue Microphones, Zoom Cameras, LP Percussion, Roland, Oralex, and Source Connect Pro. You can also download the InterTalk Radio app on your iPhone or Android. Bobby Watson has a reputation for bringing a solid foundation to any rhythm section, but he particularly shines in the band Rufus, which he joined in the early 70s, 74 to be exact. Bobby has been a major contributor in helping create the Rufus sound, not only with his playing, but also as a producer and songwriter on all the Rufus albums starting in 1974 until the present. Rufus released 11 albums from 1974 to 83. Rufus and Chaka Khan has also won many awards, including 2 Grammys and 10 gold and platinum records. His style of bass playing can be heard not only on Rufus, but in other artists such as the Pointer Sisters, Jumpin' Jack Flash, what you just heard in the intro, Michael Jackson's Rock With You, and Billy Preston's Nothing From Nothing, just to name a few. Bobby's also been a producer in multiple acts, including 4 years with Rene and Angela, which the last record, Street Called Desire, went gold. Bobby's also produced Plush, featuring Seidah Garrett, Janet Jackson's opening debut album called Janet. Bobby resided in Japan for about 10 years also and took part in countless productions and recordings and tours. Once back in L.A., he joined up with his buddy Steve Harvey, and their relationship resulted in them writing over 100 songs. Bobby's also been a session player with all sorts of artists and producing Brigette McWilliams, Frank McCombs, Cece Winans, The Temps, Nadambi, Ledisi, and Rachelle Farrell. Shortly thereafter, Bobby replaced Verdine White in a band called the LA All-Stars. He also toured with Prince, Larry Graham, and Chaka Khan in Europe. Bobby and I took part in the Rufus Chaka reunion tour in 01 and unfortunately was cut short by the sad events of 9/11. In 02, Bobby joined Earth, Wind & Fire's original members, Sheldon Reynolds, Morris Pleasure, and Larry Dunn and Johnny Graham, for a concert celebrating Jimi Hendrix's 60th birthday at the EMP Museum in Seattle. Currently now heading the Rufus Experience, please welcome 2-time Grammy winner, multi-platinum artist, and bandmate, Bobby Watson. Welcome to Vinyl Night, Bobby.
Jesus, what an intro.
Hey, thanks, you did it.
That was a that was a mouthful.
Yeah.
I love it. Could you say all that again one more time?
I could do it like one of those end bumpers of a commercial.
Right. Oh, anyway, thanks, man, for having me on the show. I'm happy to be here today.
You are the man. And like I do with most or all my guests, actually, I kind of start from the beginning because, you know, when you're little, you get influenced and that changes or helps pave your direction. And, you know, you were from Memphis, right?
Yeah, I was born in Memphis, Tennessee. Yeah. That's right. Yeah. And when I was about 6 years old, I used to go out and go up the street. There was an old gentleman that would come out on a porch and sit and play like a hollow body Gibson guitar. And he'd sit out there every day and play like honky tonk blues. And I was fascinated. I'd go sit under him and he would just play this blues, just play. And I'd listen and I just fell in love with blues. And after that, I started to systematically beg my mama for a guitar. Mama, please, can you buy me a guitar? Please, mama.
Yeah.
I begged her every day. And finally, Christmas came and she bought me a six-string Roy Rogers. I remember it very clearly. It was red and white, and there was a picture of Roy Rogers on trigger, and he had a lariat, and the lariat went around the F-hole, you know, the sound hold on the guitar. And I played that guitar, and actually when I got it, I took it up the street to the old man that sat out there, and he showed me how to tune it up, and the both of us sat there and played honky-tonk together. And it was nice. Actually a pretty nice guitar. It had six, plastic strings, a catgut. There were no steel strings, just plastic strings. But it was able to tune up good enough for me to learn to play, just a little bit of blues. But that was the beginning of music for me. After that, I was hooked.
Did your dad or mom, were they musical?
Not my dad. Well, actually, no, I'm wrong. I just found out from my older brother that my dad played banjo. Him and one of my uncles had a little band, and they played banjo, and one played guitar, and I think they had a washboard or something like that. And, you know, they'd sit around on Friday night. They didn't do gigs or anything, but, just for their ears, they would sit and play and jam. Right. And I had a grandmother that was a songwriter, and she played a little piano. And my Uncle Sam was a blues artist back in the 50s. He actually went on the road and played Sweden and some European cities. Uncle Sam, the blues man. Yeah.
Well, so it is in the blood.
Yeah, kind of, yeah. I left Memphis when I was 9 years old and moved to L.A., so I didn't really stay there long enough to become a blues man, but I think some of it did get in my blood, you know, so.
Yeah, so, I mean, how was that move for such a young age, getting out to L.A.?
Yeah, it was nice. I mean, you know, living in the country, there was about 12 of us living in the one house, a little shotgun house. And my mom moved us all to L.A. And, you know, it was a little bit more room. My sisters all got jobs and got their own families started. And I was, you know, I enrolled in my first school that had, lockers and showers and different classrooms. Because in Memphis, it was, the school there was all, you know, everybody went to one school and all of us was in one class. It's like all the 12-year-olds and, you know, all the 10-year-olds, all the 9-year-olds and 8-year-olds were all in one big room. But when I moved to L.A., there were like, you know, several, you know, it was more room for the classrooms were smaller. There were like 20 kids instead of 60 kids. So it was a lot better. We had showers. And in Memphis, when I lived there in that little shotgun house, we all had to take baths together in one bathtub. Every Friday night, my mom would boil water and fill it up. And, of course, the older people got to take the first bath.
Oh, boy, so and you were not one of the older kids. Ones.
Yeah. By the time I got in the tub, You can imagine how the water looked.
That's why you're so funky.
I think there's a saying, like, throw the baby out with the bath water.
Oh, geez. So then, all right, now I heard, well, which I already know this, but, you know, you started playing sax then at age 11?
Yeah, that's right. Tony, that's when I met Tony Maiden, when I left the 49th Street Elementary School and started going to Carver Junior High. I really wanted to be in the band. And, you know, of course, there's no guitar in the band. It's an orchestra, you know, it's orchestral instruments. And so I went immediately for the tenor sax because around that time, my older brother, Chesterfield, was bringing all these Miles Davis, Coltrane, Gene Ammons, Sonny Stitt, all these albums home. And I'm like digging on this jazz. And so I wanted to play tenor. I got in the band. Tony got in the band too. Both of us were too late to get any of the saxophones. So he ended up on, bass clarinet. And I ended up on regular clarinet. But, you know, we made it through that first semester, and then the next year we both got saxes. So we did play sax in junior high.
Wow, cool.
Yeah.
And did you guys at that point have a band, or what was your first band? Do you remember?
Yeah, actually, that was, you know, after a couple of semesters messing around. Well, when I first met Tony, some of my friends were telling me, you know, there's this guy who's a good guitar player. Maybe you should meet him because you play guitar too. And I met Tony, and he was good, and I was impressed. And we became friends immediately, and we started walking home from school together. Because we lived a couple of blocks from each other. And we started walking home from school together, and we hung out, and we talked. That's all we did all day and night was talk music and bands and, you know, our favorite songs and all that. And eventually him and I started a little band and entered the talent show. Our first drummer was this girl, Ava Nelson. She could play drums a little bit. She could keep a beat going. And we got Ava in there. It was more of a novelty, but it actually worked. And Tony had twin brothers, Rodell and Donnell. And so his brothers were twins, they had a lot of shirts that matched.
I know where you're going with this.
You know where I'm going, right? So we were the best looking band because we had matching shirts in the talent shows. We won talent show every year, our little trio.
Were you playing guitar, or when did you then switch to bass?
Well, we had two guitars and drums at first, and that didn't work because in 1964 this group came out called the Beatles, and we fell in love. But we realized that the Beatles had a bass player and two other guitar players, and so I relegated myself to playing bass. Tony, I don't think, wouldn't have made a good bass player. He had that really nice rhythm in his right hand. He had that nice rhythm feel. Right. And I said to myself, I don't want this guy playing bass. I'll play bass, and we'll write songs together, but I'll take the bass. And our first bass, we actually were not able to afford to buy a bass. So I remember up on Central Avenue, there was a church that I attended Sunday mornings, and the pastor of that church bought instruments for his service, and we'd go up there, and that there was a white some kind of a Gibson or some kind of a silver tone bass that was always laying on a chair in the up in the pulpit. And so we decided we need a bass. Let's just borrow, which now I can say we would go in and steal the bass on Friday and Saturday and use it and make sure it was back in the church on Sunday morning.
Right. You were intonating
but
it.
We borrowed it. Yeah. We were improvising in those days. So, you know, we'd borrow it. And the other thing I remember that was kind of cool was Tony Maiden's house in his backyard. He had a garage, but the garage was torn down. But the foundation for the garage was still standing there. I mean, it was still on the ground. It was like concrete. And it kind of looked like a stage to us. So the three of us, me and Tony and Ava, would set up our little equipment on that concrete, and we would rehearse in Tony's backyard. I know the neighbors hated it at first. But, it was kind of fun. Yeah.
Yeah. So, you know, as the segment, one is flying, by the way. So then you met a mutual friend of ours, Al McKay, at age 16, and became.
Yeah.
Maybe you could tell us a little bit about that.
Yeah, I was mowing the lawn one day out front, and this guy pulled up in a little MG convertible, and he says, "You Bobby Watson?" I said, "Yeah." "Who are you?" He says, "My name's Al." He says, "You don't know me, but some guys told me that you are pretty good bass player." And I said, yeah, I play a little bit. "What's up?" He says, "Well, I have a gig, and I need you to come help me out." And Al was a couple of years older. I think he was 18. I was 16. And he was still in high school. But Al was one of those young get-up-and-go-getters. He was already playing in a lot of bands and working with, you know, Sammy Davis Jr. and writing for different people. He was already, you know, started his career. And so Al said, "Well, I have a gig for you. It's up in San Francisco, though." And I said, "Uh-oh, no, you got to talk to my mom about that." And so Al went in the house and talked to my mom. 20 minutes later, he came out and said, "Pack your bags." And which is the name of a Rufus song. Pack your bag.
Hold that thought. We'll be right back with Bobby Watson.
Are you serious about your music? Are you ready to run with the big dogs? The experts at Pitbull Audio have the gear to get you into the game. From leading manufacturers like Mesa Boogie, Fender, Pioneer, and American Audio, to sound your best, you need the best. Pitbull Audio can deliver in rehearsal, on stage, and into the big time. Dropping beats, shredding guitar, or making the crowd roar. Whatever you dream, Pitbull Audio can help make it happen. We are Pitbull Audio. We want you to play it loud. PitbullAudio.com.
You know what's all around you every waking moment of your life? Marketing. You're choking on it. I'm Scott Robertson, and when it comes to strategic PR, branding, and marketing, I've seen it all. And actually, I'm still seeing it because bad marketing never sleeps. Join me each week on May the Best Brand Win, right here on InnerTalk Radio, and learn how to make the marketing for your brand unforgettable.
Hi, I'm Tim Dolbear, the host of Sound Experience on InnerTalk Radio. Each week, I talk with top professional audio engineers, producers, musicians, and the manufacturers that make the tools that we use in the studio each and every day. From capturing the perfect take to mastering your final release, and the tools and how the pros use them, we are going to dive deep into their process and learn from their experience. I look forward to you joining us each week on Sound Experience with me, your host, Tim Dolbear.
Hey, it's Tracy Smith
and Beth Venus
of Girls Talk Rock right here on the InnerTalk Radio Network.
Every Wednesday at 5 p.m. Pacific.
Okay, Beth, they know that, but we want you to know that the industry pro's choice is Silver Tiger Production.
STP is a full-service production agency offering sound, lighting, installations, talent buying, staffing, backline equipment rental, and sales. Kapow!
It's everything in the entertainment performance industry. It's all at...
It's all that!
SilverTigerProduction.com.
Back with legend, two-time Grammy winner, Bobby Watson. And when I first heard that song, man, I freaked out. I swear, you know, because I was still in college. I was still in college in Boston. I go, shit, I want to play that song with that guy. And it all came true. But
you ended up doing it. Up, yeah, you're here.
We ended up doing a lot. But the Al McKay segue, and you know, coming out of the segment one, I think may have been partially cut off. Can you maybe finish that?
Okay, yeah. I'll make a long story short. I ended up actually at 16 years old, leaving home, driving up to Oakland, Berkeley, Richmond, San Francisco, playing behind a singing group called the Whispers. And Al McKay was the MD, and we had a little trio, guitar, bass, and drums, and we backed up the Whispers all that summer. And, man, they paid me a couple of $100 a week, which in 1966 for a musician was really good money.
Yeah.
Of course, I sent all the money home to my mom. But that was my first experience playing a pro gig and playing with some real musicians behind a real group. That was my introduction into the professional music world.
Had you purchased a bass at that time?
No, I used a Fender Precision bass with some heavy gauge Labella strings on them, which I had never played. And I had some blisters getting used to that thing, but yeah, that was my break-in period.
Well, you know, a lot of people know you of you and your, you know, your foundation of musical tracks. But speaking of track, a lot of people don't know that at Jefferson High School in Los Angeles, you were a track star.
And oh yeah.
I know for a fact, because you and I raced once back in the old days, and I got my ass smoked. So tell everybody what your time was in the 100-yard dash.
Well, that was because we were in the mountains, and you had trouble getting your air.
you got a point.
I think we're pretty evenly matched, you and I, because you're a fast dude, too. But I held the record. I held the record for the 100-yard dash. They didn't have meters back in the 60s. We ran yard races, and I ran a 9900 at Jefferson High. And I guess for about 10 years, my record stayed there, and somebody finally broke it. So it was no big deal.
Unbelievable. I was more of a 220 guy, so you know. You are halfway down the track by the time I catch you. So
right.
Anyway, and then you joined and formed a band called Rhythm Rebellion.
Yeah, that's right. Yeah, that was with Tony too. We both were in the Rhythm Rebellion, and that was a good band for experience for us because we did a lot of traveling. We went to France. We played in Saint-Tropez out there on the French Riviera in this club called Biblos. And we went to Italy and played in some big discos over there. And we ended up in Naples. Then back through, we played on a ship coming back from through the Straits of Gibraltar over to New York. We were 10 days on an ocean liner, played a gig on there, and then we played in New York and Canada and Mexico. We did a lot of travel in that band, Rhythm Rebellion. That was good for us. Good experience. We didn't make any money.
Well, you had fun, though.
Yeah, we had fun.
young fun. Well, then that led into the Billy Preston introduction. Why don't you tell everybody about that?
Yeah, well, that band, the Rhythm Rebellion, we were based out of a club on Crenshaw called Mavericks Flat. And Billy lived close, and he used to come to Mavericks. And he would play, and he would hang out and just be like one of the beautiful people that went to that club. There were a lot of celebrities. Marlon Brando used to come there. The other actor, I can't remember his name now. I'll think about it for a minute. Yeah, there were a lot of famous actors that came there and big-time people. And so Billy would come to the club, and he'd see the band, and he picked a couple of us to come up to his house and jam once. And that was it. He just loved the way we played, and he started to use us on sessions and on live gigs. And my first gold record was Nothing from Nothing. That was from Billy's I think this was his first album on A&M. And playing with Billy there was a lot of perks playing with Billy. I mean, he was a crazy guy, but he was the Rolling Stones. He worked with the Stones. He also worked with the Beatles. He was the fifth Beatles. So we got to meet George Harrison up at A&M one night at the studio. George came, and we all were there and kind of jammed and played around. And it was the first time I seen a Rolls Royce with a Mickey Mouse decal on the window. I was like, who took a perfectly good silver cloud and ruined it with a decal? But, you know, the Beatles were,
They'll catch on. Yeah, they'll be all right.
Yeah. a lot of perks with Billy.
Right, and that led into, and I just read about this story. I mean, you were in a band on CBS or Columbia called High Voltage, which I had that record, and somebody told me that Miles Davis helped get this band signed.
Yeah, Miles was friends with our drummer, Fred Allen Murphy, and I guess they had a friendship from way back in the Buddy Miles days, and some kind of hook in with Hugh Hefner. I don't know. It's the strangest thing. Fred was a detective in Phoenix, Arizona, who was a drummer. And Hugh Hefner, you know, of course, the rich Playboy Mansion guy. And Miles Davis, who was a jazz musician. But they all had a hookup together. They were all friends. And so Fred actually started that band, High Voltage, and asked Tony and I to play. And when we got in there, we were in New York once, and Fred came to my room and he says, come on, I want you to go with me somewhere. I have to go and talk some business. And he didn't tell me anything about we're going to see Miles until we got there. And it was a boxing gym. And I don't know why Fred brought me with him, but Fred and I walked in this gym, and this dude turned around, and it was Miles Davis. And I was like, oh, shit, that's Miles Davis.
Man.
And we walked over. He said, hey, little brother, how you doing? I said, hey, Miles, you know, nice to meet you. And Miles was actually standing there punching the big bag with the big heavy bag. Yeah. He was punching the heavy bag, and he had on shorts and everything. It was like, I think Miles was actually – you know, a boxer then, or wannabe, or was trying to be. But he was hitting that bag, and, you know, he dried off and started talking to Fred. Fred was trying to get him to help us get some gigs while we were on the East Coast. And then I found out later that Fred told me that Miles actually got us our record deal with Columbia, which I didn't know. None of us knew. Yeah.
Wow, that's great. That's absolutely great. And, of course...
This led into,
but you know, maybe that whole point though led into you know, you and Tony joining Rufus in 1974.
Yeah, we stayed on the road with that band, High Voltage, for about 2 years. And at the end of the 2 years, we came back to L.A. with our tails tucked under our... We were done. We had been, living in motels, eating, $3 a day. We really had been become road dogs. We were actually having to meet girls at the club to have a place to stay. And that was no fun in Chicago, 5 degrees below zero. Not having any money and being in a band. There's lots of stories that happened to me and Tony in High Voltage during those 2 years while we were out trying to make the band popular by playing gigs. But actually, once we got back to L.A., Andre Fisher called my house and said, hey, there's... three of the guys and Rufus, because we had seen Rufus play in Chicago when we were in High Voltage. While we were there, right. We saw Rufus and we met Chaka and we fell in love with her because she was screaming her heart out and not screaming, but singing, with conviction. You know, you hear singers sing and you go, oh yeah, this girl is good. But Chaka was like more than good because when she opened her mouth, you could feel her guts. Feel her giving you everything from the bottom of her toes. And I was like, and Tony said to me, and we laughed because he said, wow, this chick is like Vavoom. And I was like, Vavoom, yeah, Vavoom. I don't know if you know, John, there was a cartoon earlier in the 60s where this character had a big mouth. And when he opened it, all he said was Vavoom, and the mountains would fall over from. Do you remember that cartoon?
I remember. I do, yes. Vavoom.
Yeah, well, Chaka was our Vavoom. So, once we got back to L.A., Andre Fisher called us and said, hey, three of the guys in Rufus quit, and we need, could you and Tony come over and, come over and play? You know, Rufus, we need a bass and guitar player. And I said, oh, is Chaka there? He says, yeah, just me and Chaka and Kevin. I said, I will be there. And I went and put my bass back together. It was in two pieces. The neck was separated from the body because I took the train home from Chicago. And so I put my bass together and put some strings on it and got on the bus and went over to Crenshaw Boulevard at Maverick's flat. And me and Tony, we went and then we jammed that day. And it was another guy that we didn't know, Nate Morgan. Andre knew him, and so that was the beginning of that second stage of third stage of Rufus. Was me and Nate and Tony joined Andre, Chaka, and Kevin, and the band sounded great. I mean, it was like a boom, automatic chemistry between all of us that day. And Chaka was there; she was pregnant, and we were jammed. She was pregnant with Malini. And but she still had good voice, and we were jamming. And I told Andre, I said, I don't know what you're going to do, but I'm in.
Right.
Yeah.
And it worked out because didn't you guys do some sort of Do Tell Me Something Good on a Bob Hope TV show?
Yeah, that was at Central Park. Once Tony and Nate and I joined Rufus, Tell Me Something Good, which was already recorded. I didn't play on that. Dennis Belfield played the bass on that. It was already starting to get airplay. And so what I essentially did was join a band that had a hit record coming out on the radio and was climbing the charts. So I started to make money. I remember coming home from Seattle with $500, $600 in my pocket. And I was like, Jesus, this is money. I'm happy. Right. This music actually, actually can be a source of income. And then we started to do real gigs then. The six of us, we started to get gigs come in, legitimate gigs. And at that time, we had the old Rufus management, which wasn't able to handle the new Rufus, which was becoming popular and had hit on the radio. And so everybody was feeling it. And so I had remembered that this guy, Bob Ellis, was handling Meatloaf. And right. Bob was also handling Ron Woods, the guitar player for the Stones. But I think Ron was in the Faces then. He hadn't joined the Stones yet. And Billy Preston. And so I sat down with Andre one day. I said, Andre, let's get Bob to manage Rufus, because Bob has got a little bit bigger grasp of the industry, what's going on now, than these guys who are managing Rufus now. And so we took a meeting with Bob, and Bob immediately liked the idea, liked the band, liked Chaka, and Bob Ellis became our manager, and then we started to do big things. We started to do all the television shows, the Merv Griffiths and the Bob Hope Show, which was in New York. And, John, just a little sidebar. I want to get this in there. While Rufus was going on, Tony and I got a call from Billy Preston in 1975. And Billy called us. He says, I need you guys. Come play with me. I got to go to New York and do this show. It's a brand new show called Tell Me. It's called Saturday Night Live. And so we got on the plane. We did the very first Saturday Night Live.
Dang. Well, hey, Bobby, hold that. That's some great, great trivia. We will be right back with legend bass player Bobby Watson.
Hi, this is Tim Dolbear, host of Sound Experience here on Intertalk Radio. And Source Connect by Source Element is the essential tool that we use to link between my studio in Austin, Texas, and the WS radio station in San Diego. Now, with Source Connect, not only can we communicate in real time and with HD audio, but it's synced up and is of a high enough quality that I can use it for real-time ADR work, remote recording and overdubbing, and it even allows me to remotely control a DAW. Source Connect by Source Element, affordable, high-quality audio and video connection over the internet for all of your production needs.
This is Jackie Bertone from Jackie's Groove. Come join me weekly on my journey through the music business as I take you behind the velvet rope, interviewing industry notables such as Al Di Meola, Michael McDonald, and Al Jarreau, to name but a few. Listen to their stories on being in the studios recording number one hits and onto the stages throughout the globe. Allow me to be your music historian. You can hear me live every Monday at 2 p.m. and every Wednesday at 12 noon Pacific Standard Time or 24/7 on jackiesgroove.com. Ready to get your groove on?
Girls are talking rock again.
And people are listening.
Today we're talking bands.
Let's talk promotion. Red Giant Promo, graphics, EPKs, video, photos, social media, and brand building using content marketing.
But let's talk studio at CCMA, which is events, rehearsal, tour prep, piano, guitar, voice, rock band, lessons, workshops, and clinics. Yeah.
Both proud sponsors of Girls Talk Rock.
Get the lowdown on these services and contact me, Tracy, at girlstalkrock.com.
Are you serious about your music? Are you ready to run with the big dogs? The experts at Pitbull Audio have the gear to get you into the game. From leading manufacturers like Mesa Boogie, Fender, Pioneer, and American Audio, to sound your best, you need the best. Pitbull Audio can deliver in rehearsal, on stage, and into the big time. Dropping beats, shredding guitar, or making the crowd roar. Whatever you dream, Pitbull Audio can help make it happen. We are Pitbull Audio. We want you to play it loud. PitbullAudio.com.
That is so funky, man. You know what's cool? It's so funky. And I remember you when I joined the band in 78, and I came in with all these Billy Cobham chops, and you looked at me and you go, "Don't play that shit. Just play a groove." And I go,
"Give me the groove."
And you referenced that song. You know, it's just really simple, not tight eighth notes, but eighth notes. And it just it just goes. And it was, it you know, goes. It's your fault. Way to go, Bobby. Thank you.
Well, now you ended up, as a result, you ended up being the world's most recorded drummer.
You see, and if I had played those 30-second notes all the time, I wouldn't have got on any record. So thank you very much,
yeah,
Bobby. So, I mean, you guys then, you guys were on fire, and you started touring with the Rolling Stones and Elton John. And
Want to
tell a couple of stories about that?
Yeah, that was, that was Bob, because Bob was not from the, what I call the Chitlin' Circuit. He was, from a different world, and he always thought different. And we played some really interesting gigs. We played a rodeo in Houston, Texas. Gee. One of the biggest rodeo events of the year, and we were down there playing. I remember being on a stage and smelling cow shit, and right in front of the ring were all the action. And that was a big gig, and it really helped make the group popular. We played New York all the time. We went to London. We headlined. We also played on tours with we did eight shows opening up for the Rolling Stones. Of course, on the Stones shows, there were always 10 bands starting at noon and going at midnight, and we would be one of the earlier bands. But it was just such an honor to open up for the Stones. We did eight shows like that. And the biggest show I remember Rufus ever doing was the one at Wembley in London. We played, we opened up for Elton John, and there was about 10 bands. There was the Eagles, and there was the Crusaders, just a crazy mix of music. But there was 120,000 people. And there's actually photos of us, Chaka in her red, Bob made her wear this Indian, the big feather, the big chief outfit with the feathers, all around her, and the red leather. And I'm standing there in a blue T-shirt that says Roscoe's Waffles and Chicken. Or something like that. But Bob, he just thought different. And we did some really different kind of gigs. And then later on, we settled into doing shows like, we did a lot of shows with, Brothers Johnson and P-Funk. Right. We did a lot of shows with Parliament Funkadelic. Heat Wave, and then later on, we started doing Rufus tours where we'd have opening acts and we'd be the headliner. Right. And those were the mid to late 80s. And then you got in the band. I think you toured with us when we did some of those Heat Wave,
Brothers Johnson shows. Yeah, we did Heat Wave, and then we did Brothers Johnson and Narda, Michael Walden. Narda.
That's when we met Randy Jackson. Yeah. He was playing bass.
It's, it's hard to believe that Randy was our first opening act.
Right.
Remember? But now as a producer, you found great success, outside of Rufus by producing Rene and Angela. And, I got to work with you on a couple of those. And I remember you were the first person to introduce me to what a real loop was.
Oh, yeah.
Mic stands.
Yeah, right.
Remember?
I forgot all about that. Yeah. I mean,
a lot of people don't know
that's
that.
Funny.
You had me go out and play, and they were running like Atlas mic stands going through a quarter-inch tape machine, or maybe it's a one-inch, I don't know. And we'd pick the best two bars and chop it up and then look. And then, fly it back into the 2-inch tape, right?
That's right, yeah. And that was the oddest thing, because I think just somebody just was like in the kitchen one day eating and said, you know what? Bring the tape machine out in the kitchen and we'll roll the tape. You hold one end on a pencil. And then we went from the pencil to a mic stand because, you know, the pencil, is in your hand. And we just experimented and messed around with it until we found out that we could loop. Yeah, like you said, two or four bars that felt really good. And something about the loop, the point where the two pieces of tape was glued together, taped together, it made a kind of a little hitch or something that felt funky. You know how you listen to a washing machine? And it gets funky because something in there is making a hitch. And so the looped tape made a little hitch. And, man, we got funky. Once we had that loop down for about 5 minutes on tape, we would play on top of it, and it would make for some interesting dance grooves.
Yes.
Yeah. I forgot all about that.
Well, you know,
tell me more.
Everybody. Oh, well, you know, I'm never mind. But I remember, and, you know, your bass lines, first of all, are – you're not just coming from a bass player standpoint. You play very melodically, and I think your playing is highly represented on Michael Jackson's Rock With You. And do you remember that recording day?
I kind of remember being in the studio, real hungry. Looking at Rod Temperton going, all right, what you got now?
God bless Rod.
God bless him. Yeah, what a nice guy. He was so cool. There's a moment I remember. We did three tracks. I didn't end up on all three, but I remember playing on Let's Gotta Leave That 9-to-5 Up On Your Shelf.
Off the Wall.
Just Enjoy Yourself. Yeah, Off the Wall. Yeah, I played bass on that too. And it was a third one because you and I and Hawk did three tracks with Rod.
That's right.
And I think Marlo was there. David Williams wasn't there. It was just me, you, Hawk, and Marlo.
It was Marlo that was playing on. That's right.
Yeah. And so I don't know. I just was playing like I always do. I mean, I had my acoustic 360, and Bruce had the 360 behind one of those baffles. And so the sound in the studio, I was probably standing or sitting real close to your drums where I could like see and hear you and lock with you, because that's all I wanted to do was lock with you. If I locked with you, whatever notes I played, it didn't matter because the groove would be there. So
that was a very, very good day in recording. That's all I'm gonna say.
Yeah, but, you know, I'm surprised a lot of people come up to me and say how much they love that bass line, but I don't know, in reality it was just another one of those days where we were just grooving, that's all. I mean, we did Do You Love What You Feel with Quincy before the Michael stuff, and the Any that's Love, right. And we were grooving on that stuff just as good. So I guess that's why Quincy called us, because he liked that groove that we were doing then, and he wanted to just bring it straight over to Michael stuff. So I'm glad.
Yeah, me too. But, you know, listen, you've been mentored when you were young, and I mean, how do you mentor now? I mean, and how do you, like, what kind of advice do you give to the youth?
Yeah, Gee, I don't really mentor that much. I do have a band now, and I kind of mentor my band. And it's just passing on experience and knowledge to them about music and how to, for example, you know, I have three singers in my band, and I'm always right. telling them, you got to sing like Vavoom.
Yes.
You have to
yes.
think of your audience, even if you're playing in a club, like with 30 people, you have to project like you're singing for 10,000. That's what makes a difference. You have to really understand that, you know, you can reach, you know, you can further yourself and reach your goals by projecting, just projecting yourself out and giving all in your performance. You know, no matter what the situation, small club, small amount of people, still give it your all. And the musicians the same way. I tell the drummer that plays with me and the musicians, you know, always think like you're playing for 10,000 people and not 10. You know, just project. Right. And simplicity. And I always tell people, when you do a live gig or even a session, make sure you rehearse so that when you're in the studio and when you're on the stage, you have that foundation of knowing the song and knowing the changes and knowing the parts that you're going to play. And then when it leaves your body and leaves your fingers and leaves the strings and the speakers and go out into the air, then you have a chance to make magic with it. But if you come in unprepared and you're struggling just to make the part, you're not going to get that magic as quick as if you were prepared before you came to do the gig or the session. So just get ready, right. You know, look for that magic.
See, that's great advice, everybody, and listen to that. And this segment's winding down, and Bobby, is the Rufus experience, are you currently active right now? Are there gigs booked right now?
I have some gigs. I think my band is going to play the Java Jazz in Indonesia. We're just not getting the money. We're working on the final details for that, but I think we're going to be doing the Java Jazz in March.
Excellent.
And I'm also trying to get, I'm about to sign with this management firm, and my new manager, his name is John, too. He's we've been talking about trying to do the Daryl, you know, Daryl's House?
Yeah, oh, God, yeah, I love the show.
Oh, I love that show, too. I'd like to get the Rufus band on there, except I'm just a little bit trying to figure out how we would do it. Of course, I would go, and maybe just me and the singers, and not any and Daryl's band all the instruments.
Oh, shoot, I wanted to go.
You want to go? Would you go?
Sure. Hey, listen, you've been listening to Vinyl Night, powered by Intertalk Radio, the groove of the music industry. I'd like to thank my guest and friend, Bobby Watson. Thanks for tuning in. My contact is jr@vinylnight.com or download our app. Thank you very much, Bobby Watson. Make it your Vinyl Night. Make this your Vinyl Night. I'm John J.R. Robinson, and every week, music creation comes alive through stories, experiences, and sounds when vinyl records filled our hearts and minds. My friends and I share our tips and techniques used in creation of iconic tracks for recording artists such as Michael Jackson, Eric Clapton, Quincy Jones, and Steve Winwood, to name a few. Vinyl has emerged hot, and the soul of vinyl defines art and passion, which burns deepest at night. Tune in.
Hi, this is Tim Dolbear from Eclectica Studios. I'm a full-time mixing and recording engineer. I work with Grammy winners, labels, and indie artists. Using state-of-the-art digital mixing and restoration tools and the very best in analog gear. Really, though, it's my ability to bring tracks to life and fulfill your vision for your music. This has made me sought after by producers and artists worldwide. So spend your time working on music and not chasing a mix down a rabbit hole. Go to timdolbear.com and check out our free one-song mix offer.
You know what's all around you every waking moment of your life? Marketing. You're choking on it. I'm Scott Robertson, and when it comes to strategic PR, branding, and marketing, I've seen it all. And actually, I'm still seeing it because bad marketing never sleeps. Join me each week on May the Best Brand Win, right here on InnerTalk Radio, and learn how to make the marketing for your brand unforgettable.
Are you serious about your music? Are you ready to run with the big dogs? The experts at Pitbull Audio have the gear to get you into the game. From leading manufacturers like Mesa Boogie, Fender, Pioneer, and American Audio, to sound your best, you need the best. Pitbull Audio can deliver in rehearsal, on stage, and into the big time. Dropping beats, shredding guitar, or making the crowd roar. Whatever you dream, Pitbull Audio can help make it happen. We are Pitbull Audio. We want you to play it loud. Pitbull Audio.